I'm here with Greg and Josh from Primal Rights, who have graciously agreed to help put together this little Prometheus instructional video, and we're going to go through the basics of the machine and probably hit a few other little high points here and there as we think of them. When you get the machine, this stand does not come with it. If you want the stand, this is made by Ryan at Big Dog Steel. I like it because it allows me to put the machine on it, spin it around as I work on it, doing the assembly and everything. You don't need a stand. You can build a plywood stand. It's not as nice as this. Or you could just simply mount it straight to the front edge of your bench, your choice. When you get the Prometheus, these side windows will be held in by little screws right here. You just take those screws out. You don't need them afterwards. I just put them in for shipping. The windows are held on by magnets, and I always put the plexiglass hitting the sheet metal rather than the magnets. You could flip it around, but then you would have a gap at the top, which would let more air come in. The purpose of those windows is to keep the machine nice and clean inside so no dust gets in the bearings. And also, if you've got AC or a fan on, they should provide enough wind protection so that it does not influence the scale. Assembly. First step is probably just to screw the powder measure on. And these powder measures are all different, and they're individually timed and tuned to each specific machine. Just screw it on until it bottoms out and gently snug it up, and it will be pointing just a little bit to the right of being straight dead ahead. Next step is to put the connector link on. That's this piece right here, and you put this bent angle down through that little hole, and there's a slotted lift arm right here. It has a hole that this angle wire has to go through. I just get it started and then literally just pinch it and pinch him right in. The unit flow, I use the adjusting stem as a handle. I highly, strongly urge you to just throw the handle that comes with the Uniflow, just throw it away. You do not need it. It will cause you to try and cut kernels. I modify this to where it works like a hot knife through butter. If you do insist on using the handle and bullying your way through and cutting kernels, you will destroy the work I've done to it and have to send the Uniflow back to get fixed. Next, with this handle up, you just screw the screw into that bottom hole that lines up with it. Run the screw all the way in. And there's a little nut that you want to snug up just to lock him in place. Make sure there's a little bit of free play so that that wire is not bound between the nut and the screw head. At that point, when you move the handle down, you can see it lifts the slotted lift arm up. And that's what provides the dumping action of the weighed out charge. Coming around back to this side, very important. When this window comes off, the very first thing you do is make sure that this transport lever is pointing towards the rear. Now it's a little wire handle right here. When it's pointed to the rear, it actually picks the balance beam up, so that the bearings, the knife edges, are not on the bearings. The Prometheus is an extremely sensitive scale, and I get that by virtue of the design of the beam and the quality of manufacture. So I've provided a way to protect that. When the machine is being adjusted or when you're not using it, always, always get in the habit. Make sure that lever is pointing towards the rear. When you want to, when you're actually using the machine, you'll rotate it so it's pointing towards the front, and the beam is allowed to come to rest on the knife edges, come to rest on the bearings. Next step is to install the stopper ball and weighing tray. Now that's these two guys right here. You want to treat them like wet toilet paper, and you'll be okay and not damage them. They are fairly, they're not real robust, but they have to be lightweight to achieve what I wanted to achieve with this scale. Now, one thing I want to tell you, if you look at the wire loop on this stopper ball, you can see it's got a 45 degree bend. It's extremely important that that bend faces to the right side of the machine when it's installed. If it's not, then it may drag up the side of the weighing tray and capture a kernel or two when you're dumping, and your weighed out charge will not get properly into the case. When you install this, this is another balance beam. There's a little wire stirrup right at the front edge of this. So that wire, that stopper ball wire, has to go through that wire stirrup. That again, that's very important. So you put that in first, and then the next step will be to carefully put the weighing tray onto the weighing tray pivot rods. And that's what's going on. When I do this installation, it's going to be hard to see because I got to put my head around there to see it, but this is what you're looking to achieve. Now, after you do this, a good exercise is to actually let the weighing tray rock for a bit and watch it. If those wires are bent a little too close together or a little too far apart, they will drag on the sides of the notches that I cut in there, and it will inhibit the free rocking motion. It's important that this thing rocks freely. If yours doesn't, call me and I'll walk you through how to get that corrected. But you just want to check and make sure that the thing rocks freely after you get it installed. So I will go ahead and install this now. Stopper ball, again, the right angle, faces to the right. Put it in. Move the handle down. Comes up through that little stirrup. And then he hooks over that little wire that lifts him up. So you can see when that handle cycled, it lifts that stopper ball. To put the weighing tray on, move this down so that the stopper ball is lifted, and then you need to physically pick him up a bit. Just drop the weighing tray right in there. Drop the stopper ball into it. And then fish him over and into the notches. And again, let's watch it rock. You can see it's rocking very gently. And we're just going to watch that a minute. What we're looking for, if it suddenly, it's going to eventually dampen out. The rocking will dampen out and die anyway. But we don't want to see it get down and then just suddenly stop. We want to see it gradually taper down in the amplitude of the swing. And as you can see, this is still going. So that's pretty good. Next step, we can install the trickler. And you literally just drop the tube right into the hole there. Wiggle him until he goes all the way down, and hook up the connector to the terminal block, and just gently snug these screws up. They don't need to be torqued down, they just need to be gently snugged. Next, we're going to install your drop funnel. Now, this has a little track that it has to fit into. It's got magnets to hold it on there, but as you can see, the weighing tray protrudes downwards from the housing. You don't want to hit that, so you can't just slide it on. You've got to install it coming upwards from the bottom, put it on there, wiggle it around and make sure it's in the little track, and push it all the way back. That track makes sure that its purpose is to constrain the freedom of movement of this funnel so that the funnel cannot be moved sideways or forwards or backwards to where it's interfering with the weighing tray, because that would cause you to your scale not to be accurate. Again, so if you're taking it off, again, you've got to, you know, just pull on one, tilt it and pull two magnets off, and then just pull it straight down. A little bit more about this transport lever and why it's so important. I want to talk to you and show you what the bearing system looks like inside there. You've got this right here is your knife edges. Now, I grind these and they're better ground, and then they're better ground than any factory reloading scale I've ever seen. Then I stone them out that you literally can shave with these knife edges when I get done with them. They're hardened tool steel, but they ride in a little agate V-block. Now, agate is a type of quartz which is even harder than the knife edges. So what we have here is the knife edge riding on that bearing. So even though this is hardened tool steel, we only have line contact, so we've got a very high stress on there if any appreciable weight is put onto them. So when you're adjusting the scale, you could bump it and put a nick in the knife edges, which would degrade the accuracy potential of the machine. So I decided that I wanted to protect that, and that's the reason for having this transport rod. Again, it's very important if you're doing any work to the machine, adjustments, whatever, or if you're not using the machine, put it into transport mode with that lever pointing to the rear. Now we need to talk about the scale a little bit and how to adjust it. This is your main poise. Now, a poise is just a fancy word for counterweight. The zero position is when this poise is in the very first notch, all the way to the front closest to you. Each notch represents 2 grains of increment to the scale. So that means every 5 notches is 10 grains. I have engraved lines every 5 notches so that you can easily go to a 10 grain increment, and then from there you have to count. Now, if you'll notice, if you look closely, you'll see that the very first line, which is the zero position, and approximately the middle, and then towards the back, the next to the last one, those lines are longer. That's so that you can easily discern a zero, a 50, or a 100 grain setting, and then adjust from there. To adjust between the 2 grain increments that we get from this poise, we have the small poise up here. Now, this is a thumb nut that's on a threaded rod, so you rotate it or turn it just like a nut to advance it rearwards. The zero position, again, is all the way closest to you, so literally just unscrew that until it hits these stop nuts. At that point, there's a little detent wire back here that rides in the knurling. Now, those knurling will provide clicks, but the clicks mean nothing. What you're looking at is at the front edge up here, around the periphery, there's some engraved notches. Each one of those notches represents 1/10 of a grain, and there's 10 spaces, so if you make one full revolution, you've incremented the scale by 1 grain, and if you make 2 revolutions, you've incremented by 2 grains. Now, the zero position is marked, the zero notch is marked with some red paint. So if you unscrew it about between 11 and 12 o'clock relative to that detent wire, you'll see that red notch. So if we wanted to go increment it by 1/10 of 1 grain, you'd turn it until this next notch is right relative to the detent wire, right where the red notch is right now. So since we want to zero the scale, we unscrew this until it hits the stop nuts. We see the red notch right there. We verify that the main poise is in the very first notch, and we're ready to plug it in. When you zero the scale is comprised almost totally of non-magnetic materials, but due to the necessity of having a hard wear surface, I do have 2 pieces of tool steel in there that are hardened. They are magnetic. They are slightly affected by having the windows and this bottom funnel put on. So when you zero the scale, you always verify it as you're going to use the machine with the windows on and with this bottom funnel on. So we've got all that done. Now I'm going to plug the machine in. The power is provided by a simple wall wart, which you plug in one side into the household. The other end just plugs into this circuit board back here. As soon as you plug it in, you'll see the green glow. And there is the display. What we need to do now is take it out of transport position and into user position. Put the window back on. And that's what we're seeing. I'm just going to cycle it just so that it goes to a steady state condition. And we're going to look and see where the balance beam needle is relative to the index. In this case, it's very close. I would have no hesitation in just using the machine as is. But if you want or need to adjust that, the way that is done, move this left window. Again, the window's off, so that transport lever goes back. And I'm going to slightly, the adjustment's provided by this back leg. There's two front legs and one back leg. The back legs basically have a thumb nut above and below the base of the scale to capture it. So you loosen the top nut, make whatever kind of adjustment you might need, and then snug that top nut back down. Take it out of transport mode. Put the window back on. And then again, cycle the machine and see where it comes to rest. Looks like I might have gone slightly the wrong way. So we've got that pretty close. I'm going to call it good for the sake of it's good enough. Now, you can certainly set up and play with the Prometheus just hanging over the edge of your bench or on a stand like I'm doing here. Do not ever actually use it unless everything is fastened down so that it can't shift. If your bench is not level, like in this case, I can guarantee you this is close, but it's not exact. I can change the zero just by rotating this. So this is not a prudent way to use the machine just sitting loose on the bench like this. Once you've got it zeroed, and if at any point down the road you're just wondering, is the scale damaged or anything like that, here's a good little test you do. Is you do exactly what we've done now, have the poise at zero. There's no powder in either the trickler or the uniflow, and we've got it pretty close. You just simply cycle it a dozen, two dozen times, and you're looking to that the index or the needle always comes back to the same position. When I say same, if it's just barely out from what it was last time, that's probably as close as it'll get, but if it's noticeably, if it's out enough to where it's easy to tell it's out, then there may be something wrong. Just call me. Phone number's right here. So just cycle that. Until you're happy that it's coming back to the same zero point every single time. Okie doke. Next step, we're going to add powder. Well, let's set the scale up. I'm going to set it for 40 grains. That's a nice little in-between all-around number. So it's set for 40, and that's sufficient for us to play with. Next step will be to add powder, and I'll start out putting some powder in the trickler. when you're first starting out, I don't suggest putting very much powder at all into the trickler, between a half of a teaspoon to a teaspoon. That's a good little starting point. There will be a little learning curve as you learn to run the trickler and keep it running. There's a few different little foibles it has. They're very simple and easy once you've had the experience a time or two. But again, starting out, don't put too much powder in there. Down the road, you can add more and more powder until you have all you need or want in it. But that's something you just start with a minimum amount, get to know the trickler, add more as you need to. It only takes a second. Now we're going to just throw some powder in the Uniflow. And before we talk about how to adjust the Uniflow, let me give you fair warning. Every time you move this handle, you're going to dump powder out the discharge funnel. Have yourself a little cup or something on the bench, because every time that handle comes down, whatever's in that weighing tray is going to drop out the bottom. So to set up the Uniflow, literally just throw a charge. And what we're looking for, let me throw another one. You see how that beam came down and then came back up. So since it's up, that means the charge is light. So we can open. I'm gonna make a radical adjustment so that you can see how I set this thing up literally in 10 seconds. Throw a charge. You see that needle just dropped down, so I know I'm way heavy. Just spin that thing. Throw another charge. It's still heavy. Just spin that knob. That time it didn't even come in, so we went too far. Open it up. Throw a charge. Open it up. Throw a charge. We're pretty close. Here's how you fine-tune that adjustment. Back here, there's some little green felt bumper down here. And what I want to do is I want to see that balance beam come down, hit that green felt, and gently come up just a little bit, and then gently settle back down. If it just drops and stays, then the charge is too light. So let's watch what happens when cycling. That's too heavy. I'm going to close it half a turn. That's not too bad right there. That's good enough to start running from. You don't have to have this adjusted perfectly to start running. Get it close and start loading and fine-tune this as you're running. Now, a word of advice about it. I can easily affect the charge that this thing throws, and I'll demonstrate. Let me try and get it a little bit closer. Okay, kind of see how that needle acted. It is just a little bit light. Now watch this. I'm going to go very slow. I'm going to give it a little tap down here and slowly move upwards. This will throw a heavier charge. Now watch this. I'm going to go fairly fast. It's going to throw a lighter charge. So you need to develop a very consistent speed. You also want to get in the habit of giving it a little tap at the bottom and a little tap at the top. What that does, there's a little bit of plumbing that powder has to travel through coming out of the Uniflow and getting into the weighing tray. After you've run a bunch of powder through it, some of the coating from the powder will get on that. Everything will flow a little smoother, but you still have the potential of having a kernel or two kernels hung up somewhere in there. So get in the habit, just run it down to the stop, move it back an eighth of an inch, flick it down, run it up, back an eighth of an inch, flick it up. That's exactly the best recommended practice for cycling the Uniflow. I won't always do it throughout this video, but I'm just trying to demonstrate proper usage, and that is what I would consider proper usage. Okay, so we've discussed that you, when you operate the Uniflow, you want to have a very uniform, steady speed, not too fast, not too slow, gentle bump at the bottom, gentle bump at the top. And as you can tell just by running it a couple times, this feels so smooth, you won't believe how smooth it is. However, it is possible to feel like you're going to cut a kernel, and it'll usually happen right about here. If you feel any resistance at this point, do not force it. You will damage the internals. What you do, and that's why I don't like the handle, because you don't have enough feel. If you just operate it this way with your two fingers, like, you know, almost like you're smoking a cigarette or something, you've got very good feel and you've got more than enough strength to move and operate it. But if you do feel any stoppage right there, just stop. Don't force it. Just move it back down an eighth of an inch and then continue on upwards. And 9 times out of 10, that clears it right up. If it doesn't, just do the same thing again. So if we felt it trying to cut the kernels right there, we stop, go back down a little bit, go up. It still feels like cutting kernels. Go back down a little, maybe a little bit more, and go right on back up. But do not force that, or you will start some damage to the internals of the device. Let's watch it run a few charges now. When it's doing this, the trickler is actually running pretty fast. If you look in it, you'll be able to see that it's going really fast. Once this needle comes down approximately right here, there'll be a 3-second pause, and then the sensors will look at the position and go into a slower trickle mode and bring you down until it balances out. Now, due to the discrete weight of each individual kernel, it may not balance exactly perfectly. It may be slightly down. It could be ever so slightly above, but not more than ever so slightly. Now, how much is acceptable? Because you're not going to have every charge exactly perfect like this one appears to be. You're going to have most of them, in fact, will probably be slightly below. There's a little red button up here that you can push, which indexes the trickler for one slot, so theoretically it will drop one kernel of powder. You will occasionally have two kernels of powder standing straight up side by side in a slot, so the trickler could dump two kernels. Most of the time it's going to drop one, and let's see what happens. I'm going to look in there. There is one kernel in the next slot, so this is one kernel of H1000 or Rotumbo. Let's drop one more kernel. So you see, the first kernel moved us a noticeable amount. The second kernel dropped us quite a bit. Typically, from this point to this point is around 0.75 of a grain, 0.075 or 0.08 grains. You do not ever want to accept a charge where the needle is below the point, this bottom point. The reason being, that green felt bumper at the top, when that needle gets down below this point, it's possible that that top felt is interfering with the scale and holding it back and not giving you a true reading. But you'll almost never have an instance where you're outside the bounds of either being right, exactly right, or almost down to this bottom valley right here. I don't think there's anybody on the planet that can shoot the difference in, that would say be two kernels of Varget. Typically, you're going to find your variation to be minus zero to plus one kernel is the typical result you're going to see. I want to talk a little bit about this trickler. When you need to clean it out or whatever, you literally can just lift it right out and dump whatever powder you've got right into some container and set him right back down. At that point, if your charge ever just goes really heavy to where the needle just drops right to the bottom of the screen instantly, I guarantee you the problem is going to be powder underneath the feed plate. So you'll need to do what I just did, clean the powder out of the body of the feed trickler. Then you have to remove the feed plate to get the rest of the kernels out from underneath it. But this is also how you would change feed plates for different size powders. Take a regular pair of pliers and gently, you don't need to gorilla grip it, just gently grasp the very center hub and lift straight up. The feed plate is held on by two little O-rings with a friction fit that go around the shaft of that stepper motor. To put this back on, you know, you'd clean it out or whatever you need to do. Just set him in there. At the back of the machine, held on by a couple magnets, is going to be your little trickler tool. Just take this turn down in. These O-rings are Teflon. They're chemically very inert, which means any solvents in the powder won't hurt them, or ozone exposure won't make them dry and brittle like the regular Buna O-rings. They are prone to tearing, so you want to be gentle with them as you work the O-rings over the stepper motor shaft. The way I do that, I support the bottom of the motor, put that on there, and push and wiggle. And I only push a little bit, and then I let up. What I'm doing is just trying to get those O-rings worked over that stepper motor shaft without any tearing. Once they're over it, you can just shove him home without worrying about the wiggling or anything like that. And you want to firmly press down. That's only a friction fit, so you want it pushed down good. Put your trickler tool back on, and you're ready to add powder and go back to work. Okay, I want to discuss the reed switch. If you think about it, when you dump the powder, that weighing tray is suddenly light, and the photosensors know it's light, and it's saying, I need to turn the trickler on. But we don't want the trickler to come on when we've got the dumps operation going, because that would add more kernels to your precisely weighed charge, which we don't want. The way I keep that trickler from running is I incorporated what's called a reed switch, and that's this guy right here. Now, a reed switch is nothing but a glass envelope with two little pieces of metal that are just almost touching. You bring a magnet into their proximity, and they'll go together and complete the circuit. So right now, this magnet is right here at the bottom of this slotted lift arm, and he's well away from that, so this switch is open, which is keeping the trickler from running. As you raise the handle, this magnet comes back down here. Now that's going to close the reed switch and let the trickler run. Sometimes, and it literally could be in the blink of an eye, you stop for 5 minutes to go grab a sandwich or a drink, and you come back and your trickler no longer runs. I don't know how to explain why it happens, but sometimes just a slight pushing of this reed switch, you could take and push it from this direction and push it just slightly closer to that magnet. Can sometimes, you know, that may be all it needs. Or as you can see in this case, I've already bent this wire up a little bit in closer proximity to the magnet. You don't want those leads from the reed switch to touch any metal, and that reed switch is held in by a little O-ring underneath this screw head right here. But you may have to loosen it slightly, but typically you can just give it a gentle nudge to move it around. What you want to do is make sure that this magnet does not hit the reed switch, but you can push that reed switch until that end of that glass envelope is just right almost to the outer edge of the magnet, and at that point you should have no issues. Okay, this will just give you a little view of what happens when you cycle this handle, because all we're really trying to accomplish beyond putting another charge in is dumping the Wade charge out, and that's by virtue of this connector link back here that picks up this slotted lift arm, which raises this little wire here, which picks up the stopper ball, and this just lets you see it. Now, one thing to notice, in the instructions, I do talk about lubricating the machine. There's really only two places that I would say to use lube. Now, back when I wrote those instructions, I was advocating the use of oil. At this point, I would say no oil. What you want to do is use grease only, and I ship them out with a little bit of Moly grease, and what needs lubricated, you can see the dark sides of that slotted lift arm. It just needs a little bit of grease, and I mean just a light film. If you ever start hearing squeaks or it feels a little bit rough, get you a little Q-tip, wipe the old grease off, and this is on both sides of that slotted lift arm. Wipe the old grease off, put you a very light coat on. Now, the reason I decided I like grease better was your bearings are right inside here on both sides. Now, you see how close that slotted lift arm is? We don't want any lube whatsoever to get into the bearing system, and that's why I like the grease. It's not going to tend to run as much to where it could possibly run back and get into the bearings. So again, they come pre-greased. Only when you start feeling some noticeable stiffness in the action or you start hearing squeaks do you need to concern yourself. And then it's a matter of just take a Q-tip, wipe the old grease off, take a fresh Q-tip, put a light layer of any kind of grease. I'm not picky on that. And just give it a light coating on the faces on both this side and on the back side back here. No other lubrications necessary, except for up here. If you look at the Uniflow, I've added this little arm here, and its purpose is to hold this little magnet. Now, what that does is hold that rotor in place so that you can let it go at any point and it stays. And after a while, you'll see a little shiny silver track where that magnet is rubbing on this housing. This is a place where you could use a little piece, you know, just put a little gun oil on your finger and just kind of smear it where you see that track developing, and that will smooth things out as well. In this segment, we're going to discuss an optional vibratory trickler that I kind of developed as a result of the shortage of availability of Varget, and a lot of guys were running 8208. I did make some feed plates for the regular trickler that worked okay. Everybody seemed happy with them, in fact, but I was never quite satisfied, so I built the vibratory trickler. It's not for everybody, but it's been tested with ball powder, flake powder, and a lot of the really small stick powders like the 8208 and the 4227, that kind of stuff. Installation, it goes right in the same place as the old trickler. So first off, you remove the your regular trickler. It will come not totally assembled. You'll have to do some assembly work, which means you put this circuit board under this adjusting leg right here, and you've got to hook the wires up to the terminal block there. And then it runs off a little pager vibratory motor right here, and you just, it's a stick and peel, but the trickler shaft comes out real easy. You pull this pin and the shaft will slide right out. I'm not gonna pull it all the way out because the wires are hooked up, but it will slide right out. And this front pin up here holds the hopper in place, and it's just a couple of wire pins that hold everything together and goes together like that. So to install this into the machine, you'll have this tube here, and you literally drop it down where the other trickler tube went, and there's a recessed pocket in here that goes on, just sits on top of it. and then hook up. I would suggest you put the wire with this other little guy. This is a rheostat. That's one of your adjustment capabilities to get the vibrations just right for whatever powder you're throwing. Put that next to the brown wire, which is all the way at the back of the terminal strip. And this other wire can go under the very front screw or the next one back. It's either the red wire or the green wire. They're both going to give you those are the source, the positive, and all these other four are the negatives or the sink. After that, let's talk a little bit about there. I would say there's probably two main adjustments you want to do. One is this level leg up here. Let me turn this. I would start out adjusting it to where the body of the trickler is basically horizontal. You may fine-tune that by raising it slightly so that it's pushing down at an angle, or lowering it so that the body is tilted upwards a little bit. Depending on what powder you're doing, that's you're just going to have to play with it and gain a little experience. It really doesn't take too long. The number two adjustment is this rheostat back here. You just turn that black screw and you will see the how hard this vibrates will change as you change that. There is a third adjustment that I don't really think is necessarily needed, and that's this little wire right here. You can lower that down until it's barely touching that the vibratory motor, and that also will give you more drag on it and reduce the amplitude of the vibrations. But honestly, I think this is redundant because this rheostat right here should take care of any adjustments that are needed. But primarily start out with the body pretty level and play with the vibration amplitude by the virtue of the rheostat adjustment and see where you go. Let's put some powder in. I've got some IMR 4227. And you need some kind of a little funnel here to drop it in the hopper without too much spillage. I'm not going to put any in the Uniflow, and I've got the scale adjusted for about a half of a grain. So let's cycle it and see what we've got. Okay, since there's so much adjustability of this, the guideline I would suggest you follow for fine-tuning your adjustments for whatever powder you're running in it is to use this red button and try and adjust this trickler so it takes about four hits of this button to bring you from balanced down to this point here. That will pretty much replicate dropping a single kernel of Varget, which is a general rule of thumb on the weight of those is 0.02 grains. So we got 1, 2, 3. You can see that that's throwing a bit more than that. So, well, let's just turn this rheostat down just a little bit or and see what it does. Okay, that went. Well, let's go the other way then. That threw the charge much quicker, and that means that I turned the rheostat to lower resistance rather than a higher resistance. Okay, let's see what we've got now. There's 1, 2, 3, 4. That's pretty close. I would say, you know, you'll have to decide what you wanted to do. The if you want a finer increment on this single button, which would give you a higher likelihood of coming up closer to being perfectly balanced, then you want a lesser amount thrown with each vibration, but that will mean your trickle time goes up a little bit. Just a little bit of playing around with this, and I think it's everybody's going to be pretty easy to find what makes them happy.